Here is a picture of the lunar crater Copernicus. It has a diameter of less than 100 kilometers and can be observed from Earth with just a pair of binoculars. This image is a composite of several images taken with a telescope positioned on Earth. Individual images have been added to improve the signal. This process is called stacking. You can clearly see the structures within the crater. However, the structures do appear somewhat blurred. The reason for this are atmospheric disturbances that scatter the light on its way to the telescope. If these effects can be removed from the image, it becomes sharper. This can be achieved by a process called deconvolution. In graphic image processing, this is an important tool that serves to highlight structures better. In the investigation of the Earth's interior using seismic waves, the same principle applies. Here, too, deconvolution represents a tool for making subsurface structures more visible. Hello and welcome. This video covers an important step in seismic data processing, namely deconvolution. Using two examples, I will show you how known interference signal can distort seismic sections and how they can be removed. Then I will show you a method for minimizing unknown interference. You will learn how deconvolution can be described formally and what practical benefits it can offer seismics. In the case of the lunar crater, unknown atmospheric interference was removed using statistical methods. In seismics, on the other hand, a combination exists of known and unknown sources of interference. Here you can see a seismic profile, which, just like the image of the moon crater, has been stacked together from many observed seismogram traces. For the seismic waves, the same applies as does for the light waves. They are disturbed as they travel through the Earth, and therefore reveal only a blurred image of the subsurface. The aim of deconvolution is to sharpen the signal in the seismic profile. In this way, the individual reflectors can be better distinguished and the vertical resolution is increased. The deconvoluted profile in this example reveals clearer structures thanks to the sharper signals. For comparison, the previous slide again. In the stacked profile, there are a number of lines. In seismic, they are referred to as events, which are apparently repetitions of overlying signals. These disappear upon deconvolution. Why does that happen? Firstly, I will explain how the observed signals occur. A seismic wave is radiated by a source and propagates in the subsurface. There, the waveform is modified by reflection and refraction. The geophone at the Earth's surface records a seismogram whose waveform originates from the source signal and the Earth's structure. This connection between source and structure is described mathematically as convolution. A seismic source radiates an initial wave whose signal is referred to as a wavelet W. The wavelet W is a seismic signal with a defined beginning and a finite length. W is a function of time t. On its journey through the Earth, it encounters reflectors that modify it. The reflectivity function r of t describes the subsurface influence of any particular wavelet. The observed seismogram s of t is now equal to a function of w and r. The star stands for convolution and entails the following operation. The wavelet w is pushed piece by piece over the reflectivity function r and is multiplied with it. The individual results are then added and the seismogram is transformed into a summed trace. The convolution is therefore a type of sliding averaging between the two functions. The process illustrated is used for modeling synthetic waveforms. They can then be compared with observed waveforms. This is also referred to as forward calculation. In practice, the opposing route is desired. This reverse calculation is referred to as deconvolution. Deconvolution extracts the reflectivity function from the observed seismic signals and thereby better represents the reflectors in the subsurface. The problem is, the seismic waves are not only formed by the main reflectors. Indeed, a large number of secondary effects also distort the useful signal, which is of interest in the analysis. In order to remove such distorted signals from the seismogram, individual deconvolution filters are used, which remove their own individual parts of the distortion. I now present two such interference effects induced by known subsurface structures as examples. The first is caused by multiple reflections referred to as multiples. They can be well explained using a marine seismic example. There, seismic waves are produced with air guns, special acoustic sources, near the water's surface. A fraction of the wave energy is initially reflected by the surge reflector. It is then reflected from the sea surface and the bottom of the sea. This reflection is repeated several times, so that part of the seismic energy remains trapped in the water layer. Other parts of the signal are first reflected at the bottom of the sea. However, such reflections superimpose those waves originating from the desired reflector in the Earth's subsurface. This reflection effect at the bottom of the sea is called reverberation. This explains repetitions in the seismic profiles as we just saw. If you know the travel time of these reverberations, they can be removed from the seismic profile. Another example can be seen here. A source in the ground is initiated by seismic explosive blasts. Then there are waves, of which some are radiated downward and others are radiated upward. The upward radiated waves are reflected by the overlying weathering layer. These are referred to as ghosts. They interfere during the recording of the signal of the desired, singly reflected signal path. Because the depth of the source blast is known, one can remove the ghost signals by deconvolution. As a result, only those wave components remain in the seismic profile that are directly reflected at the target boundary layer in the subsurface. The two examples revealed known interference signals. Their impact can be calculated in concrete terms. A bigger problem, however, is when there are subsurface heterogeneities and scattering bodies that are unknown. The resulting effects have to be removed using a deconvolution procedure that assumes no knowledge of the subsurface. I will show you such a method now. The aim of the deconvolution is to determine the reflectivity function R, so that reflectors in the subsurface can be better resolved. As you have already seen, R is linked via convolution with the wavelet W to the seismogram S. Now imagine a wavelet W that corresponds to a delta function, that is a unit impulse with a duration of zero. The convolution of R and the delta function would be equal to R. The resulting seismogram S would be equal to the reflectivity function R, and the goal will have been reached. A real source can, however, produce no unit pulse and always has a defined duration. You can, however, manipulate wavelet mathematically in such a way that a unit impulse arises. For this purpose, ideally, a deconvolution operator D is required, for which the following applies. D convolved with W equals delta. For D convolved with S, this results in the convolution of D, R, and W. Since the convolution is subject to the commutative rule, the operators can be interchanged. We just defined D convolved with W as delta, and it follows that the convolution of the deconvolution operator D with the seismogram S results in the desired function R. Practically, the wavelet cannot be transformed into a perfect delta function, but one could try to approximate it. Norbert Wiener in the 1940s developed one such filter through curve fitting using the least squares method. The so-called Wiener filter is designed in such a way that its convolution with a given wavelet exerts a minimal deviation from the delta function. The Wiener filter deduced in this way now allows the seismic profile to be deconvolved without knowing the exact origin of the interference signals. Wiener filters are also used for optical image processing, such as that used in the introductory example. In this video, I have introduced the concept of deconvolution. You have learned that a seismogram consists of interference signals as well as the desired reflections at geological layer boundaries. The seismogram is produced from a convolution of the wavelet with the reflectivity function. The mathematical process is also referred to as convolution. The reverse process is deconvolution. In the seismic profile, this corresponds to sharpening of the events and, as such, an increase in vertical resolution. A deconvolution of unknown interference is often carried out using a Wiener filter. Its convolution with a given wavelet approximates a delta function most closely. This filter can remove unknown interference signals from the seismic profile and, in doing so, produce a better image of the subsurface.